Thank you, Mr. Chairperson. I'm sorry the whole thing has to be readjusted because the power failed on this side. And this is not an infrequent occurrence. Whenever it happens with me in my lectures, between the lectures, I think of children who are supposed to be learning online in the remote places, difficult places. How are they managing? Sometimes I get very upset when I have to stop my lecture after 10 minutes, 15 minutes. I hope it doesn't happen today. Sir, I'm extremely happy to be part of this whole thing. I have learned my initial lessons in community education from late Sri Ramlal Parikh, who was so affectionate to me and had guided me to transition from physics research to education sector. Yes, we have the pandemic. I am supposed to talk about it, its impacts, and these have been discussed in detail. I have heard Professor Arun Kumar and also your initial remarks, and we have talked about numbers. There is much more than numbers. And I think even if Corona is under control, say within next 6 months or 4 months, its impact will continue to haunt us for several years ahead. I have seen the despondency and demoralization amongst young persons, adolescents. What will happen to me afterwards? Those who are getting very high marks, they say 95% and more in CBSE. Earlier it was about 37,000 and now it is more than 70,000, a double of that number. It is a double. Yes, numbers are in abundance available. But these numbers have not brought cheer on the face of the children. We had never established a system of evaluation which could have become an alternative and had generated confidence. We all in education, we have been told, we have been taught, and we have taught that the best evaluation can be done only by the teacher concerned, one who teaches. He, the learner and the teacher together can do the best evaluation. But all our education at present, and we have realized it during the pandemic period, is reduced to textbooks, teaching in the schools, and examinations. As the director of NCERT, I feel related to every young person who has ever read an NCERT book. But I also hold myself responsible for certain practices which have not been under control. As Professor Arun Kumar mentioned, when I was teaching something to my granddaughter, and I said, no, this should be written like this, she said, no. My teacher had told me it has to be reproduced exactly like the NCERT textbook. Answer must be the same words, same sentences. And I realized, yes, we have done this. Why am I mentioning this? Because quality is the concern now. It is from information society to knowledge society to wisdom society. And therefore, if this transition has to take place, everybody must comprehend what is the meaning of cognitive capital of a country. And this pandemic has definitely impacted the cognitive capital of the country. I can mention a couple of things as assigned to me in my lecture. That home learning, now a lot of consideration is necessary for home learning. What should be the shape of home learning? How could it be stress-free? And how could it really be contributing? Now disruptions in instruction is worrisome, but disruption in interactions amongst peers with teachers is certainly more worrisome and impacted things more adversely. In countries like ours, in India and other similar conditions, similar economic conditions, the feeding program, the nutrition program, the regular programs of vaccination and other respective children should get health checkups, all has been impacted. And so this is the time for institutions and education systems to find out how these things can really be internalized in the system that if there are tough situations, how do we deal with this? The digital divide is really very immense. It has brought a lot of, it has widened the gaps that were already there. Digital learning has already come in before the pandemic came. It became a necessity during the pandemic, but it has accentuated the gap that happens in our case. And all of us know, whatever we might have mentioned in the Constitution, whatever policies were mentioned, in India, the education is sharply divided. It is divided from those who can afford financially and those who cannot. Now, this pandemic has created a new situation. In several states, the enrollment in government schools, Sarkari schools, are increasing. I have seen the decline over the last 60 years. I have seen the decline of the credibility of government schools. My personal interpretation of the constitutional mandate is that till they attain the age of 14 years, it should have been the total responsibility of the state to give them education. And if the state had accepted that in initial years, there would not have been this gap of haves and have-nots. Instead of doing so, what the state did, it encouraged private entrepreneurs. And as Professor Arun Kumar was mentioning, slowly it became a commerce of education. And this commerce of education is something which is detrimental to the spirit of the Constitution of India. Same quality of education to all, irrespective of any diversities of caste, culture, economic, social, and variations. We have not been able to achieve this. Now the digital divide has told us that this gap is widening. You see, people have done it. Our teachers have come up. They have come with alternative. They have tried to find out. But yes, not every teacher was proficient in this online teaching. They did not know whether same materials can be used. Some of them used to send. Just they would photocopy and send it on WhatsApp to the child and say, this is digital learning. I have seen it. Children have come to me and we have seen this part. I have talked to the principals and others. But anyway, I should accept that we are moving ahead and we have done a lot on that. But will it be sufficient? Nobody can say. This digital divide will definitely impact our quality of education in future. And our intention of giving equality of opportunity to every child. And therefore, this is the time. We have a new education policy. This is the time to find out how can we really look after these aspects. And therefore, you know, we have so many webinars. I have attended so many and I have said no to so many. And there are vice chancellors who have told me that their university, they had more than 700 or 800 webinars. I think there should be some sense of discipline on this. We should get into action. We should develop action plans at every level. Every child has to be looked after when he comes to school. First, I should say that a lot of preparation is necessary to give confidence to parents and children to come to school. Number one, this is necessary. While there are recommendations that children should be brought to schools, if you talk to individual parents, they are very apprehensive. I have talked with at least more than 15, 20. They are worried. They say, who will guarantee? Who will guarantee security? But there are other implications also. Staying in home for 18 months, 16 months, or 14 months has resulted into mental agony, emotional agony. And therefore, schools must open. Medical advice must be heeded too. But pre-opening preparation in the schools is a must, and there the work culture has to change. We are accustomed to taking things casually, but can we really transform or bring about an attitudinal transformation amongst those who are supposed to prepare schools for our children? We also have a great opportunity at this time to consider how economic crisis impacts children and their education, and whether our society is really concerned about imparting education to those who are impacted. When I mentioned that a lot of children now shift in government schools, there is a sad story behind it. People have lost their earnings. They have lost their jobs. And they are not able to choose. My apprehension is that it will affect girls' education more adversely than boys. There are parents who have withdrawn the girls from the school altogether or shifted from a fee-paying school to a government school. Several things can I can go on listing, but I know the time has the limitations. Coming back to quality, and this I mention an anecdote. See, Professor D.S. Kothari was the chairperson of the National Commission on Education, which worked during 64-66 and resulted into 1968 policy on education. That policy on education, you know, policies can make a big difference. I would mention one. It was for the first time, because the vision of Professor Kothari, that science and mathematics were made compulsory for both boys and girls. And it was, I remember people protested. And they said, girls cannot do mathematics and science. But today we know what a great visionary Professor Kothari was and how he could manage it. Millions and millions of girls have been benefited by one policy statement. The point I want to make is the title of the report submitted by Professor Kothari and his commission was Education for National Development. After about 25 years or so, about 88, 89, a query was posed to Professor Kothari, sir, if you become the chairperson again, and you are asked to reformulate the policy, what changes will you make? And the learned professor said, yes, I have thought about it. I will change the title of my policy. And the title of my report would be Education for Character Building. And he went ahead to say, I was wrong when I prepared a report under the title Education for Development. He explained further, development could have waited, but preparation of people should not have. If I had focused on character building, we would have today, India would have had young persons committed to the nation, committed to integrity, honesty, committed to human value, with high character, high motivation, high inspiration. Our Bhakra, Nangar, Bhilai, and Bokaro could have waited for 10 more years. We would have preferred poverty, doesn't matter. But whatever was being done in public interest would have been number one, grade one, class one. And that is the difference which I would like to mention here. Quality is to be redefined. Quality is encouraging every child in what Gurudev Tagore has said, power of ideas, power of imagination. These are the two boons he had mentioned. Every child gets two boons, power of ideas and power of imagination. But Gurudev also explained, but when what we do? In this system of teaching, textbook, reproduction in the examination, we are impeding the power of ideas and power of imagination at every moment. Will this change? And when, if power of ideas and power of imagination is impeded, curiosity is restricted, and therefore creativity is stunted. I think these four terms have to be very clearly understood in the context of quality enhancement of Indian education and in the implementation of the policy. A reference has come to autonomy. Yes, autonomy is essential. In NCERT textbooks, we write that we have prepared these textbooks for to set standards for the whole nation. But we would like these textbooks to be written at a state level. A local element of the curriculum must be brought in a country which is of such, with all these diversities, this is very relevant. And therefore, every teacher has to be a curriculum developer. Every teacher has to be a textbook author. He should be able to know how to formulate a good question, how to test these ideas, imagination, curiosity, creativity, from which entrepreneurship and innovations come to the country. There are two other, 4+2. We need entrepreneurship, we need innovations, but that cannot be achieved if you do not focus on permitting full flow of ideas and imagination of this. Quality is comprehension of the global situation and our responsibility. Quality is comprehension of the climate crisis, pollution, social tensions. Quality is comprehension of and finding ways and means how to learn to live together. Quality is lifelong learning. Comprehension of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. These are the factors which will have to be taken. Our education system would have been greatly strengthened and could still be strengthened if at this particular juncture things will change and change drastically. We could recall what Mahatma Gandhi had taught us. The 3x3 matrix, head, hand and heart, self, society and nature, body, mind and spirit. There can be no better articulation of our objectives, goals of education than these terms, 3x3 I see. When I visited these schools in China, my first reaction was, I think they have accepted basic education of Mahatma Gandhi without saying it so. Every school had this focus on working with the hands, social contract, and so many other things. But this today we see what is the impact of China reaching this particularly. One of the things that I think India can take a lead is, we are all talking about sustainable development goals. And we have committed to this. We have the SDG4 about which a lot of talk is going on. It should be going on. But can we forget that our children must be well familiar of the trusteeship principle which Gandhiji has told us? Can we forget that Gandhiji has said that nature has sufficient resources to meet the need of everybody, but not the greed of anybody? We can't, we have not brought these things into our education system, and that is why I say our total focus has shifted to more marks, and more marks. The result is our children, brilliant children, excellent young person, are forced to go to a coaching institute, stay there for 2 years, 3 years, and then appear in competitions in areas which they do not like. I have seen in several countries talent being nurtured by serious observation of the likings of the children in primary schools, making record of this, encouraging them. And then after about 7 or 8 years in a school, sending these children who are brilliant in a particular area to schools that specialize in those areas. I visited a physics school in one of the country, and they said they will show me a physics school. What is a physics school? Then, sir, it will also take you to a music school. In these schools, children learn every total curriculum as such, but special attention is paid to music or physics or whatever other subject. That is how you nurture talent. That is what we need to consider at this stage if we can do. In the pandemic days, I was also thinking on several occasions that our system, traditional system, was based upon Adhyan, Manan, Chintan, Upyog. These are the four steps which every teacher should know. Adhyan, all of us know, you have textbooks, you have teacher, you have classroom lectures. Manan, think about it. Let every child sit after the lecture for 5 minutes and think about it, what I have heard. We never do it in this school. It's not a part of our pedagogy. And after I came to know of this, I think it impacted me. And the third is Chintan. Talk to somebody. Talk to your friend. Peer learning, we can say roughly. And then application. Why should I learn something which I do not know how useful it would be, how it will help me, how it will help me growing up, how I will be able to utilize it at some stage? These are the aspects that we must put into this. This sustainable development goals we have in India an answer to this climate crisis and pollution that is aparigraha. We never talk about aparigraha. We never talk about sustainable consumption, which is a part of our tradition and culture. And therefore, my submission would be that the implementation of the new education policy, and if you have to enhance quality, let us make a one sentence statement. Education in India would be rooted to culture, committed to progress. We will be aware of our traditional system of knowledge creation, knowledge generation, knowledge utilization. We shall be open to new ideas from everywhere. As Gandhiji has said, that I will keep my windows and doors open, but nothing should blow away my house. That type of situation is necessary. And I think in the end, let me take 2-3 minutes to talk about teachers. Quality is teachers. Gunnar Myrdal wrote in 1970 in his book, The Asian Drama, that for these developing countries, which have recently been liberated, and that treatise of Gunnar Myrdal was discussed worldwide, he said, teacher education institutions are the power plants, are the ocean of quality for these countries. Quality would flow from teacher education institutions to the lowest point, to the initial beginning point, and from there you would generate people who will go to different professions but will be men of commitment, character, and concern. There was a committee headed by Justice J.S. Verma, former Chief Justice of India, in 2012. And it gave a report that 10,000, let me repeat, 10,000 teacher education institutions in the country are selling degrees. And this has been repeated in the National Education Policy 2020, which also states that these would be weeded out. For 8 years, they have not been weeded out. Now, if each one of them is producing 100 teachers per year, 1 year beyond, now 10,000 into 100 into 8, have so many teachers pursue the degrees. Can you enhance quality if you do not recruit teachers in the approved numbers? In a state like UP and Bihar, there have been more than 1 lakh or 2 lakh vacant positions of teachers. You apply teachers on a small salary because of bureaucratic recommendation and save money, and you have no idea what damage is being done to the cognitive capital of India. These are the things which have to be seriously thought, not only by the government. Let us not be dependent on only the systems and the governments. People have to come. The civil society, the learned ones, the knowledgeable ones must also come up and say that this is our plan. This is how quality can be enhanced. And we keep it put up wherever it needs to be put up. Quality has to be. Now we have to go to certain things. India can teach people a lot of things because we are proud of them. Aparigraha is something which can help. Gandhiji's sentence, which I just now repeated, can guide us. It is character, it is human values, it is work culture. This is how I give the example of Japan, one of the most devastated nations after this World War II. How did they rise? I was very keen to study it. And whatever I could understand was, they depended upon their teachers and schools. They had a long-term planning. And if you depend on teachers, hard work, and whatever you do for the country, that is that type of national concern and feeling is internalized. And that can come only when you are familiar of our culture, you are able to understand what are the cultural traditions you can still hold on and how they can be revitalized in the incoming context. I mentioned Dr. Kothari's name. If he could envision this, the policy at this state in the pandemic situation, when we have gone through a horrifying period, our children have suffered, our teachers have suffered. Yes, everybody is ready for a change. And let us have a very positive impact of this change by transforming the system to quality, character,